welcome. Thank you very much for coming to the session. I would love to introduce to you a true legend, especially in the music industry. This man, just to give you guys a little bit of backstory on who he is and why he's talking with you today. His mother, Mrs. Dolores Rhoads, opened up the first music conservatory in all of Los Angeles back in 1948. She was the first woman to actually achieve something like that, which is pretty amazing. This school that he now runs has many famous musicians that have gone through it. His brother, who I'm sure you all have heard of, Randy Rhoads, have written many songs out of there, used to teach out of there. As far as that's concerned, he's also a music composer. He got into his later on in his life, started composing classical music. He's now working on his fifth CD, and he also goes around touring the world with his band, honoring his brother, singing some of the old songs from Quiet Riot. But please give a warm welcome to the legendary Mr. Kelle Rhoads.
Thank you. I guess you guys are used to getting up at 6:45 or 7 o'clock in the morning. I am not, so I'm not even sure I'm up. So if anything I say makes sense, I guess I'm at least headed somewhat towards the right direction. This is awfully early for me. Okay, here's what we're going to do. The music business is a very wide and varied subject. There's a lot of components and aspects to the music business. So what we're going to do, what I've decided to do to make this a little bit more understandable to you guys, is what I've decided to do is base what I'm going to tell you on a fictitious rock band. Okay, this rock band doesn't exist, but if I use this band as a model, I will be able to represent the different interrelated things for the music business, okay? So we're gonna pretend that we've got this fictitious band. It could start in a school like you guys are involved in here. One guy meets another guy, and they start talking about the kind of music they like. And one guy goes, well, I really like this band. I think they just kick ass. And the other guy goes, yeah, I love that band too. Okay, now they have something in common. Now, after a while they start talking and they decide that they actually have a little bit more in common than the bands they like. One of them plays guitar and one of them is a drummer. So now they've got the basis, they've got the nucleus of a band, okay? Now what they have to do is they have to go out and they have to find another couple of guys, at least one more guy. You've got a lot of trios, but they have to find a singer and they have to find a bass player. So usually what happens is you talk to your friends and they talk to their friends and somebody knows somebody who knows somebody, and then they actually put the four guys together. Of course, it started with just two guys. Now, here we go on our little journey today about the different aspects of the music business. The first is instruction. Okay. Now, I come from a family that started a music school shortly after World War II, and it's still going on. We're enjoying our 69th year. And not only that, as your teacher pointed out, was one of the first music schools in the Valley, in the San Fernando Valley, that was started by a woman, when my mother was born, women couldn't vote in this country. So she really came from a long time ago, and it was really tough for women in music at that time. Very tough. It was. I guess the only way to say it is, you know, it was usually all about the men. The women were like not regarded as in the same league as the men musicians, especially in symphonic and orchestral work. So my mom started her own music school, and she did it her way, And that has spawned a dynasty of people that either taught there or went to school there. It goes on and on and on. I could spend an hour if I just wanted to drop names, but that's not important. It's important just so that you know that that's what happened. So the first subset, or the first phase we're going to talk about is instruction. That's when you go out and you learn how to play your instrument. Bass player takes bass lessons, the singer takes vocal lessons, the guitar player takes guitar lessons. So, next stage, all these guys that have gotten together and take lessons need a place to rehearse. So that's the next phase. These people are also involved in the music industry. They rent rehearsal space. Usually when you rent rehearsal space, there's different places to rehearse. Obviously, for a while, you might try to rehearse in the garage or your bedroom, but then after a while, inevitably, your parents will go, I can't take one more day of this. So you go get a rehearsal studio or go to the bass player's house and ruin his parents' eardrums. So what happens is you go seek a rehearsal facility. Now we have a second phase. We have the people that actually are in the music business, but because they're catering to musicians. They rent rehearsal spaces. They rent sound stages. Sound stages is where you rehearse your show. That's where the lighting and the stagecraft and all that come together. So when you take that show on the road, it's going to go exactly the way that you're rehearsing it. Okay? So after a while, the band rehearses, puts music together, whether it's tribute material, which means you play material from another band that's already made it. That's real popular nowadays. Tribute bands are real popular, and if you're in a tribute band, you actually get paid when you play, because there's no other reason to do it. And if you were in a band that does original music, which I usually always was, that's going to take you up to the next level, which is playing before an audience. Okay, everybody should start, everybody, playing in the garage, playing for little parties, playing for a backyard and a birthday party. And then after that, maybe you get to play a club. If you're real young, that can be a problem because there's age limits, but that can be skirted too. So you start playing and you're developing a following. What happens now? Now we have another phase, another facet of people that are in the music industry, but they're not actually up on stage playing. They're the club owners. They're the people that own the venues that you're going to play at. And I will say one thing, if I was in a band nowadays, I would not like it as much as when I was in a band in the 1970s, because back then you got paid to play in a club. Now you seem to have to almost kind of pay to play. You've got to sell this many tickets, all right? If you don't sell that many tickets, you might end up owing the club owner some money. Wow, that's something that was unheard of back in the day when I came up, but that it does exist. So now we have the musical instruction. Those people are in the music industry. You have the people that rent rehearsal studios, sound stages. That's in the music industry. Then you have the club owners. Now this is where a lot of bands fall off the chart. They don't make it past this stage, okay? Some kind of a conflict comes up. They don't get along anymore. Inevitably, there'll be a conflict between two people in the band and then the whole band will split up. But if you make it past this stage to the next stage, what happens now is you're very successful, you're playing places, people are filling the halls, they like the band, it's successful. Now you get into another phase of people that work in the music industry, but they don't actually play an instrument. Now you get into the phase where you need an agent. You might even be approached by a manager. People think that when a band needs a manager, or when they think they need a manager, they go out and they go to a place that says manager. Like, you go to a place to buy tennis shoes, says shoes. It doesn't work that way. What happens is the manager will come and find you. Why? Because they know how they can make money. They know if the act is something that they want to become involved with, because there's a potential. So, here we have another aspect of the music industry. Agents and managers. A lot of people think that what a manager does is call people up and see if they can get their act to play there. That's actually against the law in California. You cannot manage a band and book the band too. All right? Now, here's something that needs to be, here's an afterthought, it needs to be injected. When a band is coming up, usually the first people that approach the band to manage the band are not legitimate managers. They're fangers. What that means is there's somebody who hasn't a job in construction, or they're an accountant, or they do some other kind of thing, and they want to pay for everything so that they can consider themselves the manager of the band. They're really not. They're really not, because I'll tell you what a manager is. A manager is somebody that can pick up her phone or his phone, and they can make things happen. They can connect the dots. And to be able to do that, you have to have a track record in the industry, and you have to have managed people that accomplished a certain career standard. Somebody that manages a band like Kiss, they can pick up the phone and they can make things happen. Somebody that manages a local band that nobody's ever heard of, well, he can say he's the manager, but he's really not. He's really not. He's just kind of paying to be in a certain spot. Because he doesn't play an instrument, he can be the manager of the band. So, now we move on. The band's successful. They have a manager. Somebody approached them that has a track record that represents artists that are further along on their career. The band signs with said manager. They get a booking agent. They get somebody to book the shows. Now comes another phase of the music industry. Here's where you have engineers, producers, people that work in the recording studio. These people also do not play on stage with the band. They might play with their own band. They probably are. Most of the engineers that I've ever worked with, they also play instruments and they play in bands. But the other stage that we're getting into now is people that will actually capture what the band does. Okay? They're the engineers. They're the producers. A lot of times you have people that do both. My engineer is named Brent, and he wears a couple of hats. He engineers me. He does all my music in the studio, and he helps me produce it. But his day job is he's Sebastian Bach's lead guitar player. I don't know if you know who he is, but he had a real big successful band a couple of years ago called Skid Row, and they were very, 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 very popular, and they were real successful. So now we get into another stage. You have signed with a record company, the few big ones that are left, okay, and now you have all kinds of support people that are in the music business that don't actually get on stage and play. They don't show up at your shows and jam with you. They're the people that work in the record company. Back quite a while ago, after I had gone to college for about 13 minutes, I decided that I wanted to get a job in a record company. And fortunately, I was teaching a kid drums, and his father was the vice president of Capitol Records. So I had a real unique experience. I went down to the Capitol Record Tower that you see in Hollywood when you go on the freeway, this big, huge, round thing. And I went there, and I went to talk to his dad. his dad said, look, it's highly unusual that a vice president of a huge record company would hire somebody to work in the mailroom. So I guarantee you, you'll have a job, but go down to human resources and give them this note from me, and you'll probably get a job in a couple of days. And I did. And it was probably one of the best, if not the best job I ever had in my whole life. It was absolutely incredible to go to work every morning, sort mail, deliver mail and packages in that tower, and the people that I got to meet, unbelievable, unbelievable. It was really, really, really great. So back on track, you got people that work for the record company, and they are behind you and working in the music business, but as I said, they don't actually get up on stage and play with you. Okay, now, here is the next stage of the music business. The next stage of the music business is support group. You need people to take that act on the road. You need roadies, technicians. You need a front house engineer. Front house engineer runs your sound, as opposed to an engineer that runs the equipment in a recording studio. The front house engineer runs your sound. You, if you're a band that's any good, you're going to have one, because you play different size rooms all the time, and it sounds different. And sometimes it doesn't sound so good because the acoustics vary. Okay, so you travel with a front house engineer. You need a crew. People call them roadies. They call them techs. Almost everybody has a guitar tech. They keep the instruments in tune, and they can do minor repairs, or if you're in the city where you need a major repair, they will know where to take the instrument to get it repaired, okay? So you need these people, who are also in the music business, to support you and to make it possible for you to play on that stage every night. Now we get to the very last stage or section of people that work in the music business. Very, very, very important. You need an accountant. You need an attorney. My family has three music lawyers. They all do different things. And we have to have three of them. And they're not cheap. A music lawyer is about $500 an hour. Okay? And if you're in the music business, you have to have one. You have to have one. Because you're going to get ripped off anyway. With a music lawyer, you don't get ripped off quite so bad. So, then you need an accountant to watch what the other accountant is doing. Okay? I didn't make that up. James Brown used to say that. So, you need an accountant. You need an accountant for the accountant. And then you need a music lawyer. Maybe you need multiple music lawyers. We have one that just does percentages. When we sign my family, when we get involved with things and we sign deals, one of the biggest points that everybody argues about is what percentage. What percentage is the people, in our case, it's our family, what percentage are we going to get from endorsements and products that are put out where they say the Rhoads family endorses it, and they show our picture. Or they make some video and we say a bunch of dumb, stupid stuff to make everybody think, oh, okay, well, they like it, so I should like it. Okay? So, anyway, so that is really, really, really essential. The final piece on this little model we're building with the different interrelated things that actually do make up the music business, the final thing is when somebody becomes real successful, when they get to the point like an Ozzy or a Mick Jagger or somebody that's way up like that, they need another person to help them live their life because they're so busy. There's no way they could even come close to sorting out what they get invited and asked to do. There's print ads. There's television shows. There's special. There's charities. Once you make it, the first target, everybody and anybody who has a charity is going to go after you, and they're going to ask you if you'll take part of their charity. Some charities are really, really good. One charity that's great is the one headed by Wendy Dio. She is the actually the widow of Ronnie James Dio. I'm willing to bet that most of you guys don't know who that is. But anyway, he was the high-level mark on heavy metal singing. Nobody could sing like Ronnie. He's passed away. Her charity is called Stand Up and Shout, and it benefits children with cancer. Very, very, very good charity. We're involved in that with her now as a result of meeting her recently. So you are a target for people that want to use your name and likeness and image to help them do what they want to do. And the thing that's real important to say here, because I feel that I haven't done you a service unless I mention this, the music business, I'm still in it after 40 years. It is exciting. It can be great. All the places I've gotten to go in the world is because of the music business. And I've been to some really cool places and had some beautiful memories. Problem is, music business is cruel. It's heartless. All the really rotten people I've ever met in my life, I met them through music. It is a very cruel, heartless profession. Know that. Understand that. Now, in my case, and I know it was my brother's case, I have no choice. I have to do this. If I'm not playing piano, I'm dreaming about playing piano, or I'm talking about piano, and sometimes the people I talk about it to, they don't like it as much as me, and they get sick of hearing it. My wife says, don't talk about piano no more, just go play it someplace. The thing is, a lot of people want it. There's a lot of people that want to come out here and be an actor. That looks like a great job. Look at the cool people you get to hang with. You probably get oodles of money and you get to live in the Hollywood Hills. Okay, they don't know when it rains real hard, but the house comes down anyway. But that's beside the point. Anyway, so here's the deal. In my case, in my family, I have to do this. There's nothing else to be done. I've been a milkman. That wasn't so great. I delivered juice. That wasn't that great. But music, that's it. That's it for me. That's how I know your teacher here, music. So what I'm trying to say, in summing all this up, what I'm trying to say is there are many interrelated facets of the music business. Somebody that's an engineer, they're in the music business. Somebody that stocks the shelves at Amazon, and they put the artist's music there, so when people order online, it can be delivered. That person's actually in the music business. The agent is in the music business, and the accountant who oversees the other accountant, he's in the music business. It's not just the players. The players is the real glamorous thing. That is what most people get into the music business to do. To play, to perform, to record, or to teach. Teaching is real important because we have to take care of the next musicians that are coming up. We have to make sure that you people at your young age go in the right direction to fulfill your career dreams. Very, very important that a generation takes care of the next generation. Somebody that's been there has to help the people that are going there. And like I said, the music business, and I'll repeat it once more so there's no doubt, it's tough. It's really, really, really tough. And if you think you're going to be a rich rock star, you're probably not. The people that I've met that have been real successful, they literally couldn't do anything else. They had to do music, whether they made money or not. My little brother was probably, I think it's safe to say, he's one of the most famous guitar players that ever lived. He never said he wanted to make a bunch of money or be a rock star. In fact, he was real uncomfortable with that description. He would always say, I'm not a rock star, I'm a guitarist. If you really, really, really have to do this, if it's your passion, it's like these, you know, people who get passionate, like, you know, Van Gogh, he got so uptight, he cut one ear off, still painted. By the way, what's really sad about him is in his lifetime, when he was alive, he only made $7. You know what? Do you know what a Van Gogh would go for now? Do you know how much money a picture that he painted would fetch? It's astronomical. So that's sad. That's when people don't get appreciated in their own lifetime. And that does happen. That does happen. So I think I've given you kind of an idea that there are interrelated positions, jobs, things that people have to do to keep the music business running. And they are certainly not all based on you being on stage actually playing an instrument in a band. The performing side, that's one aspect of it, but not the only aspect of it, and not the only reason people get into it. Okay, now, I think I might have spoken a little longer to this class than I did to the other one. So if there's any questions at all, I think we maybe should address them now, because it looks like people are gathering for the next class. You in the back.
Kind of random question. My mom and grandparents are actually buried at the same cemetery as your brother. And I'm just curious, what's the connection to San Bernardino?
I didn't hear the first part of that.
Your brother is buried
right
in San Bernardino.
That's he is.
My grandparents and my mom are buried at the same cemetery. And as I pass by his monument, I've always wondered, what's the connection to San Bernardino?
Okay.
Not exactly the center of the universe there.
No, it isn't. I just want to ask you, were your ancestors, were they residents of San Bernardino?
I'm from there.
Okay.
So, yeah.
All right. Here's why he's buried there, and so is my mother. Oh. When my mom was born, which actually, interestingly enough, was before women had the right to vote in this country, okay? Wow. When she was born, women couldn't vote in this country. And she was born into a family that had a very prominent and successful physician. Her dad was Dr. Fred B. Kell, hence my name. That's where I come from. I'm the very last of the Kells, and I have no children. So after me, it's just air. So she was born to Dr. Fred B. Kell and my grandma, who I loved so much and I used to spend summer with, and it was so great. San Bernardino was a great city back then. And so my mom wanted him to be interred in San Bernardino because she wanted to be interred in San Bernardino. She was born there and she grew up her whole life there until she went away to college. And then she came here and went to UCLA and got her degrees in music. So that's why he is buried there. And I'll tell you a weird story here real quick. This is chilling. Do you recall that about a year ago or so, there was a situation where a terrorist shot up? You know what I'm talking about. That was like a day before we buried my mom. And so we're all out there. My brother's birthday's on the 6th. We buried her on the 5th. Because we wanted her birthday present to be her son returned to her. So what happened was this thing comes off. We have a day until the burial of my mother, and it was the most eerie thing to go to that city. That was on Waterman.
Yeah.
That's where that happened.
Yeah.
The cemetery's on Waterman too.
Yeah.
It was a weird, surrealistic experience. I kid you not.
I live in San Bernardino now. So again,
I used to spend my summers on Arrowhead.
Yeah.
I had a younger brother and sister, and to keep me from beating on them, my mom shipped me out to San Bernardino, and she goes, "You're going to spend the summer with your grandma. You watch Sheriff John eat potato chips." And I went out there, and man, it was a beautiful experience. Beautiful experience. It was a way different city back then than it is now. In fact,
when you want to invite the seniors ahead to lunch, we truly do thank our presenters.
Cruel profession. Know that if you're going to get involved with it. It is not fair. It's cruel. It's heartbreaking. That's the way it is, and that's the way it is for the people that have made it. They've transcended that, and they've come out on top, but it was probably not an easy road. It's a very, very, very tough profession. A lot of people want to do it. Everybody comes out of California, want to be an actor, want to be a musician, want to be in a band. It sounds glamorous, but there's a lot of people that want the same dream. But know this, if you do get involved in the music business, it's tough, it's cruel, and it's heartbreaking. And you heard that from me, so. All right, I guess we're done. Thank you very much. I appreciate the round of applause. I hope I've enlightened you a little bit.
And guys, he has flyers to his school if you're interested in taking music lessons at Masonia.
I have flyers for the school in case anybody's interested. I would prefer it if you really are thinking about studying an instrument. Nice to meet you.
Precis qui pro nobis.